Today we're going to study the Yawa Kalahapi Sutta, S35.248, Sanyutta Nikaya, Chapter 35, Sutta number 248. This has been translated in Sutta Discovery 40.3, Volume 40, Chapter 3, or SD 40.3. The Yawa Kalahapi Sutta is a short sutta, but it's very instructive in different ways. The theme is very simple. It's about the six senses and how the six senses, eye, ear, nose, tongue, body and mind, sometimes run out of control and bring us suffering. So here it is a reflection on how not to let our thoughts run wild through the six senses, so to speak. Yeah? And according to the sutta, there are half a dozen ways in which we should avoid the kind of painful experience, if you like. And I've written the keywords on the board behind me. The first word there is conceiving, right? We conceive things through our eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind. What we see, hear, smell, taste, touch, and think. Conception, that means creating new ideas, which is not there. And then mental disturbance. In other words, we think about something that we have created and we feel troubled by it. Mental agitation. The mind cannot be calm, like a fish jumping up and down on dry land. Mental proliferation, that means one thought leads to many more thoughts. Thought explosion, so many thoughts until we get stressed, feel troubled, we feel all kinds of suffering, mind-made suffering. And then the sixth one is falling into conceit. In other words, we start comparing ourselves with others, measuring ourselves against others. We try to be fashionable, we try to be better than other people, or we feel bit downhearted if we consider ourselves to be less than other people, or we might even feel proud that we're as good as someone else. Right? This is conceit. So this sutta also has got what is called the story aspect. We have a short mention of a war between the Devas and the Asuras, and how their leader Vipachiti got captured, and what happens to him? If his mind is a bit filled with ill will, then his mind is filled with loving kindness. So the first half of this sutra is instructive. It talks about the six senses, how we should take charge of ourselves, we have peace with ourselves. And the second part is a reflection. The second part is a kind of sutta meditation. There are many people in the world now, monks and lay people, they use the suttas as a kind of meditation. Now, if you think that you have difficulty in meditating, sitting and meditating, watching the breath and other kinds of meditation, one way is to read the sutta reflectively. Now, I'm not saying you must read the whole sutta from beginning to end. Choose some inspiring passages that you like, certain sections. Just the section which helps you to feel good and happy, or which is meaningful to you, or which helps you to calm your mind. So read silently if you like, or under the breath as they say, or if you're alone, even aloud, but mindfully, in a sense of reflection, in a calm voice, and then at the end of it, you feel peaceful. Just sit quietly for a while, just like that. This is called Patisalana, a kind of solitary retreat, if you like, reflecting on the suttas. And as you do this, you find your mind becoming more calm, and you're able to sit mindfully. You're already meditating. The sutta is a set of instructions that teach us how our minds can become calm and peaceful. So this is where it would be very silly to say, oh, the suttas are so difficult. oh, the suttas are, what you call, too long, and so on. Right? These are things that prevent us from being, from having wisdom. So we always be foolish and dependent on others for instructions and so on. So here's a chance for us, in other Sutta Suttas, to bit by bit, to know ourselves. The Sutta is about ourselves. The Sutta is not there to trouble you. The Sutta is there to free you from suffering. It is your defilements that's preventing you from wanting to read the Sutta. Sexual desire tells you, oh, you know, I got something more interesting to do. And ill will tells you, oh, this is so boring, and I don't like the Sutta, I can't understand it. But there's so many suttas, thousands of suttas. And then the restlessness and remorse, you feel, you worry about so many other things, instead of looking at the medicine, the Dharma, the suttas. And then you feel sleepy and tired, so you think the Sutta will not help you. And then finally there's doubt. So this is the snake biting its own tail. So can you imagine how painful it is? So doubt is telling ourselves what to do. I don't know this, I don't know that. So we do not make the effort to study, we always be in doubt. If we do not make the effort to ask good questions, in the sense that the question we ask in the Dharma is a good question. We follow the Dharma with a willingness to learn. That's how wisdom grows. That's the main difference between a foolish person and a wise person. A wise person is willing to learn. A wise person was foolish once, but is willing to learn, asking questions, and always a good listener. So this is something, these are the basic things we must remind ourselves. To love the Sutta, to love learning, and in a sense, to hate ignorance, to avoid craving. So we begin our path to wisdom by listening to the suttas. Now let us look at page 80, the discourse on the shift of Bali, Yava Kalapi. Yava means Bali, it's a very ancient grain found in India, in the ancient world. Kalapi is a shiver, kind of like a bundle, if you like. The sutta starts with a parable, the sheaf of barley flailed. Bhikshu, suppose a sheaf of barley were thrown down at a crossroads. Then six men were to come, each with a flail in hand. A flail is a long stick, you know, for beating the grain so that it will be separated from the husk. And they were to strike that sheaf of barley with their six flails. Thus, Bhikshu, that sheaf of barley having been struck by the six flails will be thoroughly broken up. So, six men with six flails, six beating sticks, so they all come and start beating up the grain. Gets broken up. Six, very symbolic, right? Six represent the six senses. And the sheaf of barley represents us. Okay, it's the person. You know? So we are assailed by our six senses. What we see, hear, smell, taste, touch, and think. We have to deal with all these things. They are like six phones ringing all the time. To answer them, to deal with them. The sutta continues. Then a seventh person were to come with a flail in hand, and he would strike that sheaf of barley with the seventh flail. So we have an extra person, number seven. He continues to beat it. Thus indeed, Bhikshus, that sheaf of barley, having been struck by the seventh flail, would be even more thoroughly broken up. So here the Buddha is using a very common, very well-known activity by the ancient Indians. Even today you will find this being done, maybe by machines, but long ago it's done by flails. So the house is separated from the grain. 4.1, even so, bhikshus, the ignorant worldling is struck in the eye with forms, agreeable and disagreeable, struck in the ear with forms, agreeable and disagreeable, struck in the nose with smells, agreeable and disagreeable, struck in the tongue with taste, agreeable and disagreeable, struck in the body with touches, agreeable and disagreeable, struck in the mind with thoughts, agreeable and disagreeable. So here we're talking about only two kinds of feelings which we notice in our daily life. It's a very simple psychology here. Whenever we look around, whenever we hear something, whenever we taste something, smell, feel, think, the tendency is either we like it or we don't like it. This is the way the world acts. Yes or no, like computer, on or off, one or zero. Now if we do that, then we are heading for trouble, so to speak. 4.2. If bhikshus, that ignorant willing, notice the word is ignorant willing, were to think of further rebirths, that empty person as such would be even more thoroughly struck. Just as the chief of Bali being struck by the seventh flail. So the seventh flail, remember, it is this idea that we want to continue being reborn and going through all this again and again. In other words, you don't realize that these are things which are not really helpful. This being drawn by something we like, being pushing away something we think is unpleasant. In other words, a kind of reactive life. Okay? So if we have a reactive life, then we are not likely to be happy. Always running because we think something is good and we run to it. And avoiding things which we perceive as unpleasant. Very often, what we perceive as pleasant are distractions. Things which are not really helpful to us. And those things which we think are ugly, boring, difficult, actually can help us, for example, right? So this is where we've got to ask ourselves, why am I seeing such and such a thing as attractive? What is it that I find attractive in this thing? You learn something about yourself there. Maybe something happened in the past. Your childhood, some pleasant memory of it. And you link that to the present situation. So you're still living in the past, still a child, in other words. So sometimes we need to let go of that kind of attachment. Unless it is creative, unless it creates something meaningful, beautiful, helpful, then it is wisdom, of course. It helps. Then on the other hand, something we do not like. What is it that we do not like? To listen to the suttas or read the suttas. Or why is it we don't listen to certain teachers? And then we examine. We find there's something there related to our past, and what we expect, and so on. So there's a lot we can learn from this kind of personal reflection. Of course, this kind of reflection will not work immediately, but definitely over time, if you are this kind of person, you spend time examining yourself, like looking into the mirror of Dharma, then you definitely know yourself better. And you have a lot of time, a whole life to do this. Because if you don't, then alternative, you have to learn from others. It's a very difficult, painful way of learning. So here, the Buddha continues now. He tells a story. The Buddha tells a story of a battle between the devas and the asuras. It doesn't matter whether the story is true or not, it's just a story. The story about the devas, these are very powerful heavenly beings, they're very beautiful. And of course, they won't die until their time comes. So to them, it is like just a virtual war game. They didn't really die. And then there is the asuras, very fierce, ugly, power demons. They just love power and they like to exploit people. They don't care about others. They care only about themselves. they simply use anyone, anything for their own narcissistic agenda. Yeah? So the devas and asuras often like to fight each other. This probably, of course, maybe you know, connected with some ancient battles in ancient India or maybe the Middle East. But the Buddha is using this kind of stories, which are very popular, to capture the attention of the audience and at the same time transmit deeper meanings of the Dharma. 5.1. Once upon a time, at least once upon a time. So the Buddha is telling a story here. So this story, the meaning needs to be teased out. Okay? Once upon a time, bhikshus, the devas and asuras were at war in the thick of battling. Then bhikshus Vepachitti, the leader of the asuras, addressed the asuras. If, sirs, in the thick of this battle, this war between the devas and asuras, the asuras were to win and the devas were to lose, let us bind Satra, the leader of the devas, with the five bonds. That means binding his four limbs, right? So there's like a board there, the limbs are like, the hands are kind of chained together, the feet are chained together, but just enough to walk, you cannot run. And then kind of there's like another chain to the neck. So maybe the hands are like, you know, chained to the neck. The five, it's called a five bonds. You might see this in some of the Chinese movies maybe. So, let us bind Satra, the leader of the devas, with the five bonds, binding his four limbs and neck, and bring him to Asura city, Asurapura. Then on the other, now the, imagine it's a movie, so now the, you see the other camp now, the deva camp. And Satra, the leader of the devas too, bhikshus address the devas. If, sirs, in the thick of this battle, this war between the devas and the asuras, the devas were to win and the asuras were to lose, let us bind Vepachitti, the leader of the asuras, with the five bonds, binding his four limbs and neck, and bring him before me in Sudama Deva Assembly Hall. Sudama Deva Sabha. Of course, the story often goes that the devas never lose, right? They always win, so to speak. Or at worst, they will just flee, you know, if they think they're going to lose. Now, bhikshus, in this war, the devas won and the asuras lost. Then bhikshus, the Tavatinsa devas, that is Satra's camp, having bound Vipachitti, the leader of the asuras, with the five bonds, binding his four limbs and neck, brought him before Satra, the leader of the devas, in the Siddhamma Deva Assembly Hall. And so Bhikshus Vepachitti, the leader of the asuras, was bound with the fivefold bonds. Now Bhikshus, this occurred to Vepachitti, the leader of the asuras. The devas are indeed righteous. Unrighteous are the asuras. Now right here I am. I have come to Deva City. So in other words, here you see this Rupachiti having a good mind. He's not angry with the devas. He understands it. There's respect for the devas, even loving kindness, no hatred. Here's interesting because the story shows that even asuras are capable of good acts if they try. Then he sees himself freed from the fivefold bonds, being served so that he is fitting, replete in the five divine sensual pleasures. So this is very interesting. All he needs to do is just think happy thoughts towards the devas. That's the key to the fivefold bonds, the chain. The chain just drop away and he sees himself enjoying all the goodies that the deva world has to offer. Now isn't this interesting? We have the fivefold bonds. Again, symbolic number here, a bit of numerology going on here. Fivefold. The five senses, if you like. So we are prisoners of the five senses. So we have loving kindness, you learn to master yourself, then you are free from this fivefold bonds. But the sutta continues, 7.4. But big fuse, when this occurred to Vipachiti, the leader of the Asuras are indeed righteous, unrighteous are the Devas. Right now I must go to Asura city. Then he, so this is, he's an ill will in other words, 7.5. Then he sees himself bound in the fivefold bonds, and the five divine sensual pleasures vanished. So there you are. So here, in other words, even when Vipachiti, the Asura king, is captured, if he has loving kindness, then he doesn't suffer. He's no more a prisoner. He's a guest of heaven, of the gods, of Pavatinsa. But if he has negative thoughts, then he suffers from those negative thoughts. So here's already a hint that our sufferings are mind-made. We can deal with them. Now, this is a very important teaching because it's telling us that if our sufferings are mind-made, it arises in our mind, we can stop them there. In other words, if we think happy thoughts, positive thoughts, we learn to train ourselves, we can be happy. That is why it is vital that we know the suttas, because the suttas are teachings. They are special programs to train our minds to be happy and strong, to be healing. So the story stops there. The sutta continues, the Buddha says, 8.1, thus subtle indeed bhikshus are Vipachiti's bonds. Subtle, in other words, it's mind-making. But, continues the Buddha, subtler than that are Mara's bonds. Indeed, bhikshus, mental conceiving is a bond of Mara. Not conceiving, one is free from the bad one. So here we see the first negative mental activity, conceiving. Creating ideas in our minds. What are these ideas? Here is where, if you're a psychologist, you'll find this very interesting, because here the Buddha actually lists the kinds of thoughts we have. A list of thoughts which is possible that will cause us suffering. Let me see here. You have two of the present, and then the 2, 4, 6, 7 of the future, right? Interestingly here, the past is not mentioned. Think of the present, think of the future. Bhikshus, I am. This is a mental conceiving. I am this is a mental conceiving. I will be is a mental conceiving. I will not be is a mental conceiving. I will have form is a mental conceiving. I will be formless is a mental conceiving. I will have consciousness. This is a mental conceiving. I will be non-conscious. This is a mental conceiving. I will be neither percipient nor non-percipient. This is a mental conceiving. And this teaching is a little slightly beyond the normal, because it actually refers to people who do meditate, or people who think a lot about future life. You say, oh, I want to have a future, happy life in the future. I don't want to be like this, I don't want to be like that. Right? For example, I am. How is I am conceiving? You say, I am happy, I am not happy. These are all conceptions, our own opinions of ourselves. So if you say, I am not happy, of course you won't be happy. That is why in loving kindness we say, I am happy. Let me be happy. May I be well. Right? So you tell the mind, think happy. You can do that. You don't need an external stimulus, so to speak. You just feel happy. It's possible. That's what Buddhism is trying to tell you. second kind of example of mental conceiving, I am this, meaning you see something and you say, you connect yourself with that. You see someone very rich, you say, oh, I am this. Or you see someone very poor, you say, I am this. You connect in that way, kind of measuring, if you like. Then you form ideas about yourself. Again, you know, just ideas. And our whole life is messed up because of this kind of ideas. Ideas can destroy us. So why not use ideas to liven us up, to make us happy, if it's possible. I will be, right? So this is, you think of the future, I'll be like this, I'll be like that. But the future never comes. Only the now. Because when the future comes, it's the now. So you say, I will be this, I will be that. You're missing the now. Work on the now, then your future will be safe. Or, I will not be, right? So this is the opposite, right? You think of something negative. Oh, I will not be happy. I will not be rich in the future. In other words, I will fail. Right? So I think about it, the future has not come. I will have form, okay? Now you come to go deeper. These are more like those who know the Dharma, they know about meditation, they say, wow, this form in the jhana world, very beautiful, you know, I want to be reborn there, right? But even that world is impermanent, and then when your karma is finished, you might go straight to hell, you know? It's like this game, you know? Once your karma is gone, zap, snake and ladders, you just get swallowed up by the snake and you go down to hell, right? Because the good karma is gone, so we're doing a kind of game. On the other hand, if you regularly reflect in permanent and you attain stream winning, you will never fall below the four subhuman states. You never fall into the animal world, asura world, preta world, or the hell states. Or you might say, I will be formless, right? So born a very high realm, the formless realms. Again, even that, they may be lifespan will be very long, but still permanent. Or I'll be non-conscious. Well, not many people want to be reborn in this level, non-conscious beings. In other words, consciousness doesn't exist temporarily. Total suspended animation, as it were. As good as dead, maybe. But consciousness doesn't seem... Consciousness, as we know, it doesn't seem to exist. But the moment the thought arises, then you fall from that state. And then the highest of the worldly realms, eh? Neither percipient nor percipient beings. It's very subtle level. You can't say there is consciousness, there is no consciousness. Very high level. The highest level known in the Buddha's time, short of Nirvana itself. Even this is impermanent. So we do not want to get lost in this kind of samsara. This is still part of samsara. So the Buddha continues 8.3. Mental conceiving, bhikshus, is a sickness. Mental conceiving is a tumor. Mental conceiving is a dart. So three kinds of pains are mentioned here. It's a sickness. Why is it a sickness? It's a mental sickness. It's a power thing. We say, oh, I want to be like this, I want to be like that. Right? For example, there are people, some people who are self-conscious or even narcissistic, they might say, oh, the devas are nice to me, you know, the devas will protect me, and so on. But we don't know that. All that we can say is, we think in strange ways when the reality is a problem before us that needs to be worked and solved. Mental conceiving is a tumor. A tumor is a little something on your skin growing very painful with pus in it. So if we think like this, we are building up this wrong idea. We're going to suffer on account of it. And it is a dart. Because wrong views bring on rebirth in the fall of our realms. So it's going to be very painful for us. Therefore, bhikshus, thinking I will dwell with a mind free of mental conceiving. Thus indeed, bhikshus, should train yourself. free our minds from mental conceit. Does that mean we should stop thinking? Not at all. The meaning is that whatever happens to us will happen naturally. You see things, you notice things you like or don't like, accept them as they are. Be curious about them, smile at them even if you like. And then you begin to understand yourself, why you like something, why you don't like something, why you ignore something. That's the meaning. In other words, don't get caught up by the flood and rush of this, what happens in the senses. You have seen in the TV, right, how floodwaters can be so strong. You might have seen it for yourself in real life situation. So these thoughts are very powerful, mental perception is very powerful. They can just sweep us away and we think that is the right thing. And then we get caught up with wrong views. Yeah? Now the next section is mental disturbance. We choose, I am is a mental disturbance. I am this is a mental disturbance. I will be is a mental disturbance. I will not be is a mental disturbance. I will have form, this is a mental disturbance. I will not have form, or I will be formless. This is a mental disturbance. I will have consciousness, this is a mental disturbance. I'll be non-conscious. This is a mental disturbance. I will be neither percipient nor non-percipient. This is a mental disturbance. That means you are troubled by it. All these thoughts, they're not necessary. Just let go of them. Letting go of thoughts, the mind becomes peaceful. Mental disturbance, bhikshus, is a dart, a sickness. Mental disturbance is a tumor. Mental disturbance is a dart. Therefore, bhikshus, thinking I will deal with a mind free of mental disturbance. Thus indeed, bhikshus, you should train yourself. Now, the next keyword is pandita, meaning mental agitation. Bhikshus, I am is a mental agitation. I am this. This is a mental agitation. I will be. This is a mental agitation. I will not be. This is a mental agitation. I will have form. This is a mental agitation. I will be formless. This is a mental agitation. I will have consciousness. This is a mental agitation. I will be non-conscious. This is a mental agitation. I will be neither percipient nor non-percipient. This is a mental agitation. Like mental, kind of deeper trouble in this case, because here we worry and it affects our lives. Mental agitation, bhikshus, is a sickness. Mental agitation is a tumor. Mental agitation is a dart. Therefore, bhikshus, thinking I will dwell with a mind free of mental agitation. Thus indeed, bhikshus, you should train yourselves. Sometimes just by reading all this peacefully, something arises, happiness, joy, wisdom arises in your mind. Now, this is the instruction you're listening to. At the end of this, you can quietly sit down, just reflect. The next keyword is mental proliferation, papanchitta. Bhikshus, I am. This is a mental proliferation. You start thinking I am, then the thoughts explode, many of the thoughts. I am this. This is a mental proliferation. I will be. This is a mental proliferation. I will not be. This is a mental proliferation. I will have form. This is a mental proliferation. I will be formless. This is a mental proliferation. I will be formless. This is a mental proliferation. I will have consciousness. This is a mental proliferation. I will be non-conscious. This is a mental proliferation. I will be neither percipient nor non-percipient. This is a mental proliferation. Now, here the Buddha didn't say the higher states of form state, formless state, and so on are bad. He's saying this is just a thought we are having. And once you have this kind of thought, it's going to explode into many other thoughts and you get distracted. Mental proliferation, which is a sickness. Mental proliferation is a tumor. Mental proliferation is a doubt. In other words, all this causes suffering. Therefore, bhikshus, thinking, I will dwell with a mind free of mental proliferation. Thus indeed, bhikshus, you should train yourselves. So the idea here is to let go of thoughts. Then you can see the situation more clearly. Nonetheless, you notice when you're upset, you're negative, or you're angry, a thousand voices can be heard in your mind, telling you this, telling you that, and all of them are quite negative. Right? So you don't want those voices. You have to silence them. They're not very helpful. They're very destructive indeed. And now the last one. Falling into conceit. Bhikshus, I am. This is falling into conceit. I am this. This is falling into conceit. I will be. This is falling into conceit. I will not be. This is falling into conceit. I will have form. This is falling into conceit. I will be formless. This is falling into conceit. I will have consciousness. This is falling into conceit. I will be non-conscious. This is falling into conceit. I will be neither percipient nor non-percipient. This is falling into conceit. Why so? Because we measure ourselves against other people. You hear other people talking about maybe they have attained this stage or they have heard about this stage in the suttas and so on. And you say, oh, I also want to be like that. So you start comparing yourselves, then you feel troubled by it. Suffering arises. So the Buddha says, 12.2, falling into conceit, bhikshus, is a sickness. Falling into conceit is a tumor. Falling into conceit is a dart. Therefore, bhikshus, thinking I will dwell with a mind free from falling into conceit, thus indeed, bhikshus, you should train yourselves. So the sutta ends there. Yeah? Now, what's interesting here is you find here, the Buddha is saying all these ways of thinking about the present and the future can be called conceiving, mental disturbance, mental agitation, mental proliferation, and falling into conceit. Right? But in the Abhidhamma, they try to be more exact and they try to classify how each of these thinking arises. If we look at page 77, Section 2.1.1, these are called the 9 wrong views. Eh? What are the 9 wrong views? The view, I am, the wrong view. You say, I am famous, I am not famous, it's a wrong view. I am this, or I am like this, or I am like that, it's a wrong view. By the way, I am is the wrong view, and according to the commentary, Sthagita commentary, it is conceived through craving, right? Notice, this is the commentary view. But in the sutta, it can be any of those qualities mentioned. Yeah? It can be conceiving. It can be this conceit. Right? It can be greed, hate, or delusion. But here, the commentary tried to be a bit more technical. Yeah? I am this, according to the commentary here, S.A.T.73, arises through view. Of views, yeah? But then again, not necessarily so, it can also arise to greed or hate. I will be is a wrong view. It arises to the wrong view of eternalism. We believe that, you know, there's something, an essence, eternal, God, idea, soul, and so on. I will not be, of course, when you say the not, it is annihilationism. That means you have the wrong view that, oh, life ends when the body dies. Everything ends. But that's not the case. Consciousness continues. I will have form, I'll be formless, I will have consciousness, I'll be non-conscious, I'll be neither percipient nor non-percipient, all these will be. They're all based on eternalism, the idea that there is something, an essence in our life, the soul, the self, and so on. Right? So here the commentary tried to be a bit more technical. Huh? So this is where, just to show the example here, you don't need to always accept the interpretation of the commentaries. If you are in doubt, always rely more on the suttas rather than the commentaries. So, once again, how do we use this sutta as a reflection? You can select any of these, especially the sections on the breaking Mara's bonds from 8.1 onwards. Yeah? You can just select maybe one of those sections and then just read the section calmly, reflectively, and then at the end of it, do your meditation. So we end our short sutta study here for today. Yeah? Questions? So once again, let us do a short reflection. The first fortunate thing we have is to be in touch with the suttas. To say suttas are difficult is a wrong view, and that will bring on more suffering to us in time. Instead, we should say, I will try to understand these suttas. There are certain suttas or parts of suttas which are easy for me to start with. And let me go on from understanding to understanding the suttas bit by bit. Studying suttas alone is not what we must do. The suttas have a purpose. The purpose is to calm and clear our minds, to help our meditation. The suttas are a guide to meditation, a guide to a happy mind. So when we read the sutta, we look at the happy parts and remember the happy parts and use them to feel happy ourselves. Remember those teachings and use them in our mindfulness practice, in our meditation practice. Reflecting in this way is good karma. By the power of this good karma, may our minds be at peace and attain focus whenever we meditate. May in this life itself we attain spiritual liberation, namely streamlining. In this moment of peace, let us send out our loving kindness to all our teachers, to our loved ones. May they all be well, may they be happy. And also to those whom the Dharma has not touched yet. May they open their minds and hearts to the Dharma, that they may be truly happy and liberated. May all beings be well and happy. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.